Echo and Harper Audio present Exciting Times, a novel by Naoise Dolan, performed by Aoife McMahon. Part 1. Julian. Chapter 1. July 2016. My banker friend Julian first took me for lunch in July, the month I arrived in Hong Kong. I'd forgotten which exit of the station we were meeting at, but he called saying he saw me outside Kiwa Bakery and to wait there. It was humid. Briefcase bearers clopped out of turnstiles like breeding jennets. The tannoy blared out husky Cantonese, Mandarin like a bell, and then a British woman saying, "Please mind the gap." Through the concourse and up the escalators, we talked about how crowded Hong Kong was. Julian said London was calmer, and I said Dublin was too. At the restaurant, he put his phone face down on the table, so I did the same, as if for me, too, this represented a professional sacrifice. Mindful he'd be paying, I asked if he'd like water. But while I was asking, he took the jug and poured.
"Work's busy," he said. "I barely know what the hell I'm doing."
Bankers often said that. The less knowledge they professed, the more they knew and the higher their salary. I asked where he'd lived before Hong Kong, and he said he'd read history at Oxford. People who'd gone to Oxford would tell you so even when it wasn't the question. Then, like everyone, he'd gone to the city. "Which city?" I said. Julian assessed whether women made jokes, decided we did, and laughed. I said I didn't know where I'd end up. He asked how old I was. I said I'd just turned 22. And he told me I was a baby and I'd figure it out. We ate our salads and he asked if I'd dated in Hong Kong yet. I said not really, feeling "yet" did contradictory things as an adverb, and there were more judicious choices he could have made. In Ireland, I said, you didn't date. You hooked up, and after a while you came to an understanding. Julian said,
"So you're saying it's like London?"
"I don't know," I said. "I've never been."
"You've never been to London?"
"No."
"Ever?"
"Never," I said, pausing long enough to satisfy him that I'd tried to change this fact about my personal history upon his second query and was very sorry I'd failed.
"Ava," he said. "That's incredible."
"Why?"
"It's such a short flight from Dublin."
I was disappointed in me too. He'd never been to Ireland, but it would have been redundant to tell him it was also a short flight that way. We discussed headlines. He'd read in the FT that the offshore renminbi was down against the dollar. The one piece of news I could offer was that a tropical storm was coming.
"Yes," he said. "Mirani. And a typhoon the week after."
We agreed it was an exciting time to be alive. Both storms came. Unrelatedly, we kept getting lunch.
"I'm glad we're friends,"
he'd say, and far be it from me to correct a Balliol man. I felt spending time with him would make me smarter, or would at least prepare me to talk about currencies and indices with the serious people I would encounter in the course of adult life. We got on well. I enjoyed his money, and he enjoyed how easily impressed I was by it. Chapter 2. I'd been sad in Dublin, decided it was Dublin's fault, and thought Hong Kong would help. My TEFL school was in a pastel-towered commercial district. They only hired white people, but made sure not to put that in writing. Like shark's teeth, teachers dropped out and were replaced. Most were backpackers who left once they'd saved enough to find themselves in Thailand. I had no idea who I was, but doubted the Thais would know either. Because I lacked warmth, I was mainly assigned grammar classes, where children not liking you was a positive performance indicator. I found this an invigorating respite from how people usually assessed women. Students came for weekly lessons. We taught back to back, besides lunch. I became known as the resident Lady Muck for stealing away between lessons to urinate.
Ava, where were you?
Said Joan, my manager, one holy and apostolic, which there was money in being, though not Catholic, since there wasn't, when I returned from a toilet break. She was one of the first Hong Kongers I'd met. It was 5 minutes, I said.
Where are the minutes coming from?
Said Joan.
Parents pay for 60 per week.
And what if I end the class slightly early, I said, then start the next one slightly late, 2 minutes from one, two from the other?
But that's two from the start and two from the end of the middle class.
Joan tried to gesticulate, but found it difficult to mime a three-class sandwich as a two-hand person. She abandoned the endeavor with a tart sigh, like this was my fault. I needed to take it to a higher power. Our director, Benny, was 40 and wore a baseball cap on backwards, either to look like he loved working with kids or to stress that he was his own boss and dressed to please no one, not even himself. Hong Kong born, Canadian educated, greasy and parsimonious, he owned a dozen other schools and, evocatively, I felt, an Irish seaweed company. He spoke of this last as back in Connemara, a place neither of us had been, though I supposed that enhanced the poetry of it. The book stopped with him, a reflection of his general distaste for parting with currency. When Benny came at the end of July to pay me, I said I was thinking of leaving.
Why? He said. You've been here a month.
I need to go to the toilet between classes. I'll get a UTI if I don't.
You're not quitting over that.
He was right. Aside from anything else, I hadn't quit over their racist recruitment policy, so it would have been weird to leave just because I couldn't piss whenever I wanted. I knew I'd do anything for money. Throughout college back in Ireland, I'd kept a savings account that I charmingly termed abortion fund. It had €1,500 in it by the end. I knew some women who saved with their friends and they all helped whoever was unlucky, but I didn't trust anyone. I got the money together by waitressing, then kept adding to it after I had enough for a procedure in England. I liked watching the balance go up. The richer I got, the harder it would be for anyone to force me to do anything. Just before leaving for Hong Kong, I sat my final exams. While they were handing out the papers, I counted how many hours I'd waited tables. Weeks of my life were in that savings account. For as long as I lived in Ireland, and for as long as abortion was illegal there, I'd have to keep my dead time locked up. That evening, I used most of the money to book a flight to Hong Kong and a room for the first month, and started applying for teaching jobs. I left Dublin 3 weeks later. The week I started, they told me the common features of Hong Kong English and said to correct the children when they used them. I go already, to mean I went. That was wrong, though I understood it fine after the first few days. La, for emphasis, no la, sorry la, wasn't English. I saw no difference between that and Irish people putting sure in random places. It served a similar function, sure, but that wasn't English either. English was British. Chapter 3. August. Julian wasn't bothered coming out to meet me after work, so I started going straight to his apartment in mid-levels at about 9 p.m. I told him I found this awkward and degrading. Actually, I liked taking the outdoor escalator up. I got on the covered walkway at Queen's Road and went uphill over hawker stalls on Stanley Street. Then signs, game and fun, happy massage, King Taylor, and high-rises and enormous windows on Wellington Street. Then came fishy air wafting up from Central Street Market and the old police station stacked with thick white bricks like pencil erasers. When I reached Julian's building, I got a visitor card from the lobby and went up to the 50th floor. Inside, his apartment looked like a showroom, the sort that had been unconvincingly scattered with items anyone could have owned. His most obviously personal possession was a large grey MacBook Pro. We got takeaway, I did the washing up, and then he'd pour us wine and we'd talk in the sitting room. The mantelpiece was bare besides an empty silver picture frame and cream candles that had never been lit. By the window was a long brown corner sofa.
I take my shoes off and lie in it with my feet on the armrest, crossing one leg over the other and alternating them during gaps in the conversation. He smoked cheap cigarettes. To encourage himself to quit, he said. We'd first met in the smoking area of a bar in the Lan Kwai Fong, where he'd either noticed me looking at him or started looking at me first until I looked back. He was good at engineering ambiguities. I was bad at avoiding them. He'd said everything very slowly that night, so I'd assumed he was drunk. But he still did it sober, so I gathered he was rich. A month into our acquaintance, he asked,
Do you meet all your friends in bars?
I don't have any friends, I said. He laughed. In some moods, he told me about markets. In others, he'd fire questions at me, only attending to my answers to the extent that they helped him think of follow-up inquiries. I'd said it before, but he wanted to hear it all again. The two brothers, the brown terraced house in one of Dublin's drearier suburbs. That I'd taken a year out after school to save up for college. That after 2008, I shared a room with my brother Tom so we could rent the other one out to a student. That none of this made us poor, and was in fact pretty much what had happened to Ireland as a whole, due in no small part to the actions of banks like his. Julian had gone to Eton and was an only child. These were the two least surprising facts anyone had ever told me about themselves. He wanted to know if my accent was posh where I came from. I'd never met an English person who didn't wonder that. Most wouldn't ask outright, and he didn't. He just asked what kind of Dublin accent I had. But they found some way to convey their curiosity. I told him it was a normal Dublin accent. He asked what that meant. I didn't know enough about British accents to make a comparison.
Well, he said, how does a posh Dublin accent sound?
I tried to do one, and he said it sounded American. He'd ask what I proposed to do with myself when the time came to get a real job. He was almost paternally adamant that I shouldn't waste my degree on lowly employers, and even paid convincing lip service to not thinking less of me for not having gone to Oxford. But when it came to which jobs he did consider good enough for me, he was vague. Law was glorified clerking. Consulting was flying to the middle of nowhere to piss around with PowerPoint. Accountancy was boring and didn't pay well. And banking, in some nebulous way, wouldn't suit me. I liked when he rolled up his shirt sleeves. He had big square wrists and jutting elbows. Sometimes I worried he could tell how often I thought about his arms. He was always calling me a freak for other, much less strange things, so I couldn't own up to it. The first time I stayed in the guest room was in mid-August when the tropical storm Dianmu hit. After that, Julian always offered to put me up when midnight approached. Depending on my energy, I accepted or got the green minibus home. The covered escalator only went one direction at a time, down for the morning rush hour or up for the rest of the day. That was the shape of it, but it didn't have a name, apart from hanging out, catching up, or popping in for a chat, which was, to be fair, the content of what we were doing. He was so stretched for time that I found it semi-plausible he just preferred to meet in his apartment for convenience. I asked whether bankers had time for relationships.
Usually not at the junior levels, he said. A lot of them just pay for it.
The way he said it made me uneasy. But there wasn't any point in taking things up with banker Julian. He was too self-assured to notice when I criticised him. He registered that I'd said something, then continued a parallel conversation. When he paid for my takeaway, or when he took me to a restaurant, and when in turn I spent time with him, I wondered if he saw himself as paying for a milder it. I liked the idea, my company being worth money. No one else accorded it that value. We sat in high-ceilinged rooms, and he said the Hang Seng was down, and the Shenzhen composite was up, and the Shanghai composite was flat. It wasn't like normal friendships, where I worried if the other person still liked me. He liked hearing himself think aloud, and I reasoned that I was profiting from it, that you never knew when you'd need facts, so it was best to collect as many as you could. One night in his living room, a few glasses into the bottle, I told him he was attractive.
I said it exactly like that. I find you attractive, to avoid seeming earnest.
You're quite attractive too,
he said. I guess that's why we get along.
Could be.
We'd known each other about 2 months, and in total, I'd spent perhaps...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.